with Anastasia Borovik. She is a postdoc at Imperial College London, and she works on understandable machine learning techniques. She got a PhD in mathematics from the University of Bologna. And before that, she did a postdoc in the CWI with us. And she will talk today about to interact or not on the convergence properties of interacting particle optimization. Anastasia, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right, there you are. Hi.
Hi.
So the floor is yours, so you can start screen sharing.
Yes.
And present your work.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes, it's full screen and it's well visible. All right, floor is yours.
Perfect. Okay, so what I want to discuss in this presentation is a bit of a more broad topic, not necessarily related to finance, but kind of more related on the optimization properties that we use in neural network optimization, machine learning in general. And in particular, the topic will be about interacting particles, so optimization using interacting particles, and I will discuss their convergence properties and also kind of a variance reduction that they achieve. So it's worked together with my supervisors at Imperial Panels, Nick and Greg. So what's the kind of optimization challenge in deep learning? Well, in deep learning, we typically have a very non-convex loss surface, something like what you see in this picture. And we are looking for optimization algorithms that are able to kind of find a good minimum in this optimization objective. So what is the goal of a good optimization objective? Well, one, we want it to be controllable. So we want to understand how can we change the hyperparameters of our algorithm such that it converges to a good minimum. We want it to escape local minimum saddle points. And like I said, converge close to the actual optimum. So what I will discuss in this presentation, first of all, I will present the general optimization objective. So what are we trying to optimize? Then I will discuss several classical optimization schemes that are used to optimize these kind of objectives and their convergence results. And related to this, also kind of a challenge or a problem with one of the optimization algorithms, in particular stochastic optimization. And then I will present the optimization algorithm that we kind of proposed in this work, which is using interacting particles. And the convergence properties of using these interacting particles. And then I will finish with some numerical examples and kind of present some further ideas as to why the optimization algorithms and the problem that we study is actually interesting also in other applications. All right, so the objective that we have in this paper is kind of a generic one. We want to try to solve a constrained optimization problem of the following form. So our goal is to minimize some function f of x, with f being our objective function, which in this, the theoretical results, we take it to be Lipschitz and either strongly convex or just convex. And x, the curly x, is our constraint set. So we want our x to lie in this constraint set. And we are looking for the minimizer x star of this objective function. Now, one way of optimizing such a problem is using projected gradient descent. So the way that works is at every time step, we take a step into the direction of the negative gradient of our objective function f. And then we project back into our constraint set using this projection operator pi curly x, with pi curly x being the closest value to our value x in L2 norm. So we are defining the projection through the Euclidean L2 norm. The drawback of such a method is that we are kind of tied to the fact that we are using this L2 norm. So we are tied to this Euclidean projection. So for example, what this can mean is that if we have a constraint set, which is depending on the dimensionality. So if we, for example, have this property here so that the distance between two points in our constraint set x and x thing is dependent on the dimensionality, then it means that our convergence rate is also going to be dependent on the dimensionality, which obviously if our problem is high dimensional is not something that we want. So as a kind of generalization of this projected gradient descent, mirror descent was introduced. for those that have never seen Mirror Descent, it might look a bit confusing, but it's not. Basically, what happens in Mirror Descent is instead of using this L2 projection that we'd had in the projected gradient descent, we use a more general thing. In particular, the projection is done using something that's called the Bregman divergence. And the Bregman divergence is defined through this phi, which is the mirror map. So essentially what happens in mirror descent is we have some value xk, which is in our constraint set. We then project it using the mirror map into our unconstrained dual space. In this dual space, we update it using our gradient of the objective function f. And then we project it back into our constraint set here now, not using just the Euclidean norm, but using this Bregman divergence d. By. So what is the benefit of mirror descent? Well, essentially the benefit is that we are free to choose this mirror map phi as we want. So if we can find a phi such that this kind of size of our constraint set with the size being defined using this Bregman divergence is sufficiently small, or for example, dimension independent, then we can obtain a faster convergence than we did with projected gradient descent, where remember that this thing was tied to the Euclidean L2 norm. So that's the basics on mirror descent. In our paper, we consider a continuous version of mirror descent where essentially we have this variable z being updated using the negative gradient and the projection is being done using this mirror map phi, but just in continuous time. Like I said, if we were to prove the convergence of this continuous time mirror descent, what we would obtain is something like this. So it converges linearly in time. And this d phi curly x is this this thing, which I kind of call the size of our constraint set, where the size is measured using this Bregman divergence. So as I said before, if we can choose a mirror map phi such that it adapts well to our constraint set curly x, then mirror descent can achieve a faster convergence than projected gradient descent. So this is the big kind of good thing about mirror descent. Now, the thing that we are looking at in this work is that sometimes the gradient estimate, so this gradient of our objective function f, it can contain some noise. So in particular, this is common if we were to compute it over a batch size of our data. So not using the full batch gradient descent, but mini batch gradient descent. Then under certain assumptions on this noise, and again, working in continuous time, we can rewrite our optimization algorithm as stochastic mirror descent, where in addition to this gradient step, we now also have this noise term. And again, the projection is done into the using the mirror map phi. So what is kind of the challenge of this stochastic mirror descent? Well, we are not actually able to converge directly to our optimum. So the distance to optimality, so the distance between our objective function f at xt and our objective function f at our optimum x star is bounded in the following way. So this first term is kind of the term we saw also with regular mirror descent, which converges linearly in time for a convex function. But we also, in addition, have this second term, which is the noise term. So our algorithm only converges to a neighborhood of our optimum, and the size of this neighborhood is controlled by this noise variance sigma squared. So the more noise, the further kind of away in expectation we converge to the optimum. Now, we're not the first ones to notice this problem. In particular, various techniques have been proposed to reduce this variance, so reduce the effect of this noise. One option is to increase the batch size, so to make the gradient estimates more exact, which amounts to essentially decreasing the noise variance over time. You could also decrease the learning rate. Various kinds of importance sampling techniques have been proposed, or other kinds of variance reduction techniques. And in this paper, we propose to take a different approach. We propose to use something we call interacting particles. So what is interacting particles? Well, typically, when we optimize an objective function f, what we do is we take some initial value, some initial condition x0, and then we run just one optimization algorithm using the gradient of our objective function f. What we propose to do is we propose to start with many particles, in particular capital N particles initialized in different locations in our objective space. And we let each of these particles run their own optimization, but in addition, we also let these particles interact. So the way this looks is, as this formula shows, we have n particles zti, with I being 1 to n. They're all taking a step into the direction of the negative gradient, of our objective function f, but they're also interacting with each other through this second term. So essentially, A represents our interaction matrix, with Aij being one if two particles are interacting, or in other words, exchanging their values. And then this parameter theta is controlling the interaction strength. So the higher this theta is, the more value we are putting on having the particles exchange their values, and in other words, converge to the same value. And then again, of course, each particle is driven by its own Brownian motion noise. We can also rewrite this algorithm in vector form. The reason that this is interesting is that our convergence will kind of depend on how our particles are connected. And the connectivity of our particles in this vector form is represented using this graph Laplacian of our interaction matrix. And in particular, how much the particles are interacting is represented using its eigenvalue. So our convergence result will in particular depend on this underlying lambda, which represents the first non-zero eigenvalue of our interaction matrix, of our Laplacian of our interaction matrix. So that's all for this slide. So what we then obtain, if we are to kind of prove the same convergence as we did for the regular mirror descent algorithm, then we are left with this bound. So the distance of our particle f evaluated at point xt to our function f evaluated at our optimum point x star is bounded using these four terms. So what are each of these four terms? Well, the first one is this one, which is the same as we saw in regular mirror descent. It's the standard optimization error, which converges linearly in time, with this the second thing, d squared, again representing kind of the distance of our constraint set, curly x. Now, the second thing, which is the interesting thing, is our variance term. So if you remember, for our regular stochastic mirror descent algorithm, this was given by sigma squared times this L infinity norm of our mirror map, but now it's actually reduced by a factor of n. So if we use these interacting particles to run n instances of the algorithm and let the particles interact, then we can actually decrease the variance by a factor of n. And these last two terms, this expected value of tilde z, this represents the deviation from the particle average. So what we see here is that if we can show that this fluctuation term, so this deviation from the particle average of each individual particle, is sufficiently bounded, then actually we can obtain a reduction in the variance. So something that was obviously our goal to achieve, because then we can converge closer to the actual optimizer of our objective function f. Now, luckily, it is the case that actually indeed our fluctuation term is bounded under certain assumptions. In particular, what we can do is we can derive the following bound on our expected value of the sum of these fluctuation terms. So just to reiterate again, each of these fluctuation terms represents the distance of our particle zti to the average, so the average of all of our particles. And like I said before, if this can be kept small, then indeed we will obtain a variance reduction. So we will converge closer to the optimum. So the bound that we see here is, first of all, we have this term which is converging exponentially in time if we take f to be a strongly convex function. And then the second term is this thing here, which from this we see that it's not increasing in n. So the more particles we have, this kind of remains bounded. And also the variance term, again, is decreased if this thing is sufficiently large. So what is this thing? Well, in this thing, we see first of all our theta, which is our interaction strength. So first of all, if we impose a sufficiently high interaction strength between the particles, then this term will be sufficiently small. Obviously, this makes sense because, like I said, imposing a sufficiently high interaction strength means that we are putting a lot of value on the particles exchanging their values. So in other words, we will converge closer to all particles having the same value. The second thing we see here is our kappa, which is our strong convexity constant. So the more strongly convex our function is, the smaller this term will be. And the third thing is this underlying lambda, which represents the type of interaction. So as I said, if the interaction is sufficiently dense, so if sufficiently many particles are at every time point exchanging their values, then this thing will be relatively high. And in other words, this fluctuation term can be bounded. So to conclude, what are the benefits of this interacting stochastic mirror descent? Well, as I said, the problem with stochastic mirror descent is that, or with stochastic optimization in general, is that we are only converging to a neighborhood of the optimum, and the size of this neighborhood is dependent on how much noise we are adding into our algorithm. You can, to reduce the effects of this noise, you can reduce the noise variance, decrease the learning rate, these kind of things, but they obviously also come at a additional computational cost. So we propose to do interacting stochastic mirror descent. So instead of just running one particle, we run n particles, and we let each of these particles exchange their values. So what we then see is that if we take a sufficiently large amount of particles n, if our function is sufficiently strongly convex, or the interaction strength between our particles is high enough and the interaction between the particles is dense enough, so sufficiently many particles are exchanging their values, then we can obtain that the variance is reduced by a factor of n, so how many particles we have, if we compare this to just running one particle or running IID particles, so particles which are not interacting. So that's the first result. What we can also do is kind of look at it from a bit of a different perspective. In particular, we can look at the convergence results from a sampling perspective. So what is the goal in sampling? Well, the goal in sampling is to run a stochastic differential equation, which at some point will converge to samples from some invariant distribution, which is the distribution that we want to sample from at some point. So what we see is that for our interacting stochastic mirror descent, if we run our algorithm long enough, our samples will be from the invariant distribution eta infinity. So with this distribution being defined in the following way, so this is our objective function, and this is our interaction part. Now, the interesting thing is that if we have converged, so why is this sampling view even relevant? Well, the point is that if we have converged to samples from our invariant measure, then actually the mode of these of this invariant distribution, so kind of where our particles are most concentrated at, is exactly the optimum of our objective function, so the optimum of our objective function f. So in particular, if we were to make this a bit more rigorous, finding the mode of our invariant distribution will be equivalent to solving the following optimization problem. So it's the same as finding this minimizer of this W, where this W is defined as this thing. And now, because of the fact that our interaction is defined in a certain way, this is the same as simply finding the optimum of our objective function. So if our samples have essentially converged to samples from the invariant measure, so if we have sampled sufficiently long from these using this interacting stochastic mirror descent, then the samples will actually lie around the minimizer. So this this then gives us an additional tool to kind of measure the convergence speed. Since if we can measure how fast our empirical measure converges to this invariant measure, this will also give us information as to how fast our particles converge to particles that are the minimizer of our objective function. The way we can study this is using various tools from the sampling community. In particular, there is this theory called Baclay-Emery theory, which basically shows that if we can prove a certain curvature condition on our thing that's kind of inside this invariant distribution, the exponent of this invariant distribution, if we can prove a certain curvature condition, then this will actually imply that our empirical measure eta t is converging exponentially fast to our empirical invariant distribution with the speed of this being defined as this through this curvature condition. Luckily, we can indeed prove this kind of curvature condition. In particular, we can show that this holds with this kind of our goal is essentially equal to this, where we have again our noise term, our strong convexity term, and our interaction eigenvalue of our interaction matrix. And in this way, what we can show is that we indeed have exponential convergence to the invariant measure. So our particles are converging exponentially fast to samples from this invariant distribution which then means that in exponential time, we will be lying close around the actual minimizer of our objective function. So this is just another way of looking at the convergence speed. I just want to kind of show that studying the invariance measure, the structure of the invariance measure and the convergence speed to this invariance measure gives you an additional toolbox for kind of understanding how fast we will actually be converging to samples from our to our optimum of our objective function. Okay, so now let's look at some numerical examples so to see how our interacting stochastic mirror descent actually works in practice. First of all, let's consider an ill-conditioned problem. So consider that our optimization objective is to minimize this wx minus b in squared L2 norm with our x lying in some constraint set curly x, which here we take to be the unit simplex. The matrix W is then sampled in such a way that it has a high condition number, or in other words, the problem is very ill-conditioned. Intuitively, just to give an overview, what ill-conditioned means is that our gradient can get very, very high, so it's very easy to kind of overshoot our optimum and not converge close to the actual minimizer of our objective function. So what we then do, if we then compare compare a different algorithm, so if we run just one instance of the optimization objective, so just one instance of stochastic mirror descent, if we then run 10 particles and let each of them interact, or if we run 100 particles and let each of them interact, what we see in this left picture here is that the one particle is this blue line. And we see that it only converges, well, it converges up to a certain value, but it doesn't converge any further after some point. But actually our interacting algorithms are able to converge a whole lot lower. So actually, like expected from the theoretical results, using interaction, we can converge closer to the actual optimizer. We can also see this represented in this histogram on the right, where actually we see that the particles with just one, using just one particle, are a lot more spread out than if we were to use 100 particles. So the histogram of 100 particles is a lot more centered, which again shows that using interaction, we are able to decrease the variance and converge closer to the optimum, also in a highly ill-conditioned problem. Another problem that's interesting to look at is a traffic assignment problem. So the objective in this traffic assignment problem is essentially, imagine we have this graph where the graph represents connections between each of the nodes. You can think of it as kind of like a map of the city where each node represents a certain location in the city and each edge represents whether or not we can travel between those two points. And the objective of this kind of traffic assignment problem is to compute given two nodes, so given A and B, to find the optimal path between these two points. So how can we fastest go from A to B? This problem can also be rewritten into our convex constraint optimization objective with a simplex constraint. So it very well fits our framework of using stochastic mirror descent to optimize it. These are the details, but I think I will kind of skip over them. But essentially what we see here is that, first of all, if we compare regular gradient descent, so the projected gradient descent that I spoke of in the beginning, and compare it to mirror descent, what we see is that gradient descent converges a whole lot slower than mirror descent. So this, this again relates to what I was saying in the beginning. If our optimization problem is of a sufficiently high dimensionality, which is obviously the case if we consider a very large graph, then gradient descent is super slow and mirror descent is actually a whole lot more convenient. If we then look again at stochastic mirror descent and kind of try to understand what are the variance reduction, what kind of variance reduction do we see in this traffic assignment problem? And if we again compare just running one algorithm, so the red thing, stochastic mirror descent, running 10 particles, the green one, 100, the orange one, or 1,000, the blue one, what we then see is, as expected again, using more particles allows us to converge closer to the actual optimum. So our particles are a whole lot less spread out. They're a lot more concentrated around our optimum, in this case, this value here. Another thing that's interesting to look at is mini-batch optimization. So remember that at the beginning, I said that another approach for minimizing the effects of the variance, so another approach for converging closer to our actual optimum, is to decrease the variance over time. In other words, this means using a larger batch size, so computing a gradient which has simply less noise. Then we're also mitigating the effect of this noise and converging closer to the optimum. So what is then interesting is to kind of compare how our algorithm using, for example, n particles compares to using a larger batch size. So if we consider, again, an optimization function of the form that I considered in the first example, where our W is this ill-conditioned matrix, but now we consider a sum over these i's. If we then sample our gradient using a subset of the data, so if our gradient is computed over this curly S, which refers to the size of our batch, so how many data points we're using to compute the gradient, then our noise is essentially included in this gradient estimate. So the smaller our batch size, curly S is, the larger our noise is in the algorithm. So what we want to understand is, how does increasing the batch size, so increasing the size of this curly S, compare to increasing the number of particles in our algorithm? If we look at the numerical examples and we run four different things. So first of all, we run a batch size, a gradient descent optimization using a batch size of 10, and we just use one particle. Then we run 10 particles using, again, a batch size of 10. Then we can increase the number over which we compute the gradient to 100, but just run one particle. Or we can use a full batch, so use all of our data to compute the gradient and then just run one particle. So what we want to see is, what is actually more useful? Well, what we see from this plot, the left one, is that if we use just one particle and a relatively small batch size, this we're only able to converge up to this this level, which makes sense since we have a lot of noise in our algorithm. We don't use any interaction. We don't decrease the noise in any other way. So at some point, we just get stuck at a certain distance to the optimum. The size of this distance is obviously defined by how much noise we're adding into our algorithm. If, however, we then run either 10 particles using the same batch size, so the orange line, or using a full batch or the gradient computed over 100 samples, the convergence is actually the same. So what I want to say with this is that increasing our batch size 10 times, so you're computing the gradient over 10 times more data, is kind of the same in terms of convergence as increasing our particles. So using, instead of one particle, using 10 particles, obtains the same convergence as using a larger batch size, but sticking to one particle. So in terms of computational cost, they're kind of comparable, and in terms of convergence speed as well. Then a more interesting problem, namely non-context optimization. So for all of the theoretical results that I showed, we considered that our objective function f was a convex or a strongly convex function. In neural networks, obviously, that's not the case, because remember this example that I showed in the very beginning, where the loss function is very often like a hugely non-convex function. Let's consider something a little bit more simple than the optimization objective in a neural network. In particular, we consider something that's called the Müller-Brown potential. It's a non-convex function with several saddle points and several local minima. So now the question is, what is the benefit of using interacting particles in a non-convex optimization problem? Well, the benefit is actually twofold. So first of all, if we forget about the noise for a second, so just consider gradient descent, no noise, and no interaction. And if we start our algorithm from a saddle point, so this orange line is so these gray lines that you see here are saddle points. The green lines that you see here are local minima. So if we start our algorithm from a saddle point, in particular, we start here around, 0.2 in our x-coordinate and 0.4 in our y-coordinate, and we consider no interaction and no noise, and obviously our algorithm has no way of escaping the saddle point, since the gradient in the saddle point is also zero, so we kind of remain stuck in this saddle point. Now the interesting thing is, if we then increase our interaction strength, so we run more particles and we let them interact and we actually put more value on this interaction, so increase this interaction strength, we see that at some point our particles are actually able to escape the saddle point and converge into a local minimum. Why is this interesting? Well, essentially what happens is that interaction adds a certain amount of instability to our particles so that our particles no longer remain stuck in this saddle point, but they actually escape it into a local minimum, something that's obviously, that could be of value in non-context optimization, where our goal is to escape these kinds of saddle points. A more common way of escaping saddle points is using stochastic gradient descent, so using the noise, because obviously the noise also adds a certain amount of instability to our algorithm. So we're also able to escape the saddle points into local minima. But if we then consider, again, let's say 10 particles and forget about the interaction, so looking at this these left two plots, what we see is, due to the noise, starting again from the saddle point, our particles are actually converging into different values. So depending on what distance the noise is pushing them into, they are converging into different local minima. This is obviously not something that we want. So if we consider the setting, for example, of distributed optimization, where we have many, many nodes, each of them are getting certain information about the objective function that we want to optimize. In distributed optimization, we obviously want all the particles to converge to the same value. So what we can then do is we can increase our interaction strength in the following way. So if we increase it from 0 to 2, in this right plot, you see that this actually allows us to control that our particles are converging to the same value. So again, makes sense from our from the way we define our interaction algorithm and from our theoretical results, namely that interaction can kind of make sure that we are keeping this fluctuation term, which I showed a few slides back, small. So, but in non-convex optimization, obviously something that could be of interest if you want to control that all particles are converging to the same value. I briefly want to kind of mention two other applications as to why this whole setting that we are considering is actually interesting, also why it could be interesting in various applications in finance. So the first thing is kind of something that I already mentioned, which is distributed optimization. So if so something that's kind of become popular recently is this thing which is called federated learning, which essentially is just distributed optimization. But the thing that's happening there is that we are having multiple nodes in our optimization setting, and each of these nodes has only access to a certain local amount of data. So this is the case, for example, when we are having data from each of the mobile devices of many, many people, and the objective is to learn kind of a global model that exploits all of the data that's stored on these local devices, but we don't want to send this data to actually a central server, we want it to remain on these local devices. So this is the setting that's the case in distributed optimization, or what they call federated learning. Obviously, this is of benefit also because of privacy constraints. We want the data to remain stored on your local device instead of being sent to some central server. So what the objective in this case is that each of our particles have access to some objective function fi of x, and their goal is to collectively optimize this f of x, which is the sum over all of the particles. Now, the challenge here is that our particles will, on how we defined our optimization algorithm, remember that our particles are exchanging their values. But this can actually also leak certain information about the users in the system. So ideally, we don't want this. Now, what's a solution here is to actually add noise to the model. So instead of just exchanging the values, we exchange values with a certain amount of added noise, which is exactly what we considered in this interacting stochastic mirror descent. And then this noise intuitively can add a certain amount of robustness to the algorithm, which then amounts to us being less able to extract certain privacy sensitive information about the users. So this is just a very, 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 very brief overview of why our interacting stochastic mirror descent can actually be interesting in a particular application, in particular federated learning, where we want to make sure that all the data is exchanged in a safe, privacy sensitive way. That's one thing. The other thing that's also interesting is that if we are again sending data from some local device to the cloud, this data can also include lots of sensitive data, again, like I said before. And ideally, what we want to do is to make sure that data that we are sending into this centralized server, it is containing the information that we need to learn the global model, but it is kind of filtering out the data that is privacy sensitive. So this is from the paper that's mentioned here. Essentially, what we want to do is, if we look at this picture, if our goal is to simply understand whether or not a certain image contains a smile or not. We don't actually need to know the way the eyes look like. We don't need to know the skin color, etc. We're only purely interested in whether or not a smile is present. So ideally, like I said, we would like to add a certain amount of noise into our data set, such that all the irrelevant data is filtered out and we are only left with seeing the smile. The reason I'm mentioning this again is that this problem, so this kind of optimization problem of which kind of noise to add such that we can still learn a good global model, but we are filtering out all the irrelevant data, this can be formulated as a constrained convex optimization problem. So again, exactly the objective that we were considering in this work for which we proposed interacting stochastic mirror descent. In particular, the problem looks like this, again, just very briefly, but the objective is to minimize the information between our original data X and our noisy data X hat, such that we can still obtain a relatively accurate model so that the loss on using our data X hat is sufficiently small. So these were just two very, very brief other kinds of interesting applications, which also definitely have interesting applications in finance, where data sensitivity is also something that's hugely relevant. So that's it for the presentation. I don't know if there are any questions.
All right. Thank you very much, Anastasia, for a very nice presentation with a lot of information and detail. I saw two questions already in the chat, and please don't hesitate to ask more questions in the chat because we have some time. The first question, already three. The first question is from Chris Verzel. On slide 35, in the distributed setting you mentioned, would you run into computational overhead problems from the communication required to enforce interaction?
Yeah, that's a very good question, actually. So I didn't necessarily go into very much detail into, wait, let me go back to my interacting stochastic mirror descent. Here. I didn't actually go into very much detail into the structure of this matrix A. In particular, the only thing I kind of said is that we want our particles to be exchanging values sufficiently often to keep kind of this this lambda value that we saw in the convergence properties as high as possible. But there are certain ways in which you can choose this interaction matrix such that you are still having a sufficiently high convergence speed so that you're not influencing the convergence to consensus, but still keep the communication cost at a minimum. So I didn't go into this, but there are ways that you can define this matrix A such that you can keep your computational cost low, but still enforce the particles to at some point reach a consensus essentially. So yeah, that's the answer.
Colm has a question. Could you say a bit more about the trade-off between increasing N and the computational cost and how this compares with traditional methods such as reducing the learning rate?
Yes, that's also a good question. Indeed, I think that's the main kind of thing that you need to understand well to understand whether this interacting particle optimization can actually be of benefit in practice. If you look at what you need to obtain convergence by reducing the learning rate, if I remember correctly, I think theoretically you obtain something like an exponential convergence of the learning rate to then converge to your optimum. So your convergence is slowed down. In our case, our convergence is not necessarily slowed down, but we do need more particles. We do need to compute the optimization algorithm for more particles. So we have kind of n times the interaction cost of an individual particle. But the good thing is then we don't have to decrease our learning rate. But to understand this trade-off, I think we only did these experiments with the mini-batch optimization, not necessarily yet with the learning rate. I think that's something we need to do for sure to understand the practical benefits of the algorithm. I guess the only good thing is that our algorithm is very easy to, or relatively easy to parallelize. So we can run each of these particles on a different distributed server and then kind of keep the convergence speed high by not having to decrease the learning rate and spreading the cost across different processors.
There's a question from Edouard. What's the nature of the particle? Of the partial? Are they, for example, eigenvalues of the noise? Could it be indexes of the neural network nodes? And how do you define A? And what are the starting values for Z? Could A be a precondition matrix?
Let me think where to start. If there are eigenvalues of the noises, I am not sure about this one, whether they can be indexes of the neural network nodes. I guess, I'm not sure, but maybe with this question, you're kind of referring to these papers where they use interacting particles to analyze the convergence of neural networks. And in this case, indeed, each particle refers to a parameter in the neural network or a node in the neural network. In our case, that's not really the case. It's a bit different. We basically, when I say particles, and if we would consider the problem of optimizing the neural network, what I mean is just we start out with, we initialize n particles at different points in our loss surface, and then we just run the optimization algorithm for each of these particles. So there isn't necessarily a connection to the neural network nodes in the algorithm that I proposed here. How do we define AIJ? Well, there are different ways to define it. It kind of refers again, I guess, to the first question. There are actually lots of interesting ways and also lots of interesting research done in how we can define this interaction matrix A in such a way that we keep the convergence speed to consensus high, but the interaction cost or the communication cost low. In our case, we for now did it very simply. We took it to be 1/n, so basically a mean field interaction matrix. But the next step is definitely to study more interesting interactions. The starting values of Z, they depend on the problem, depending on how what we're trying to solve. But I guess the only thing that I can mention here is obviously each of the particles needs to be initialized at a different point in our loss surface. Otherwise, there is no value in it. So ideally, you would kind of have them spread out in your optimization surface. And regarding the precondition matrix, that's actually also a good question. It's not necessarily the same, but there are relations between our algorithm and kind of the preconditioning algorithms. I'm only now starting to study them, so I can't give a very detailed overview, but I think it is something that we will look into for sure, because there are, like I said, these relations with preconditioning, preconditioning the dynamics to obtain for faster convergence. So it's a good point.
Then there's a question from Yu Ying. Does the method also apply to piecewise differential but non-convex optimization problems?
Yes, but I have no theoretical guarantees for you here, because right now we've only studied F to be convex or strongly convex. Again, our next step is to extend the results to a non-convex objective function. We're working on that now, so hopefully I will have a more detailed answer there. But I guess if we look at the numerical results, well, obviously this was a differentiable function of piecewise differential, but at least in this case, we do see benefits from interaction one in the form of adding instability to our algorithm. So we kind of hope interaction will do two things. So first of all, it adds a certain amount of instability. So we kind of hope that it will allow us to converge to more stable minima. And the second thing is obviously it allows to control the effect of this noise to make sure that we are having consensus if we impose a sufficiently high interaction strength. But the theoretical results we are working on.
There is a final question from Edouard. He says, did you try to use second order methods, like conjugate direction, that doesn't require linear minimization to speed up the convergence?
Yes, we did. I don't know if it's convenient. We have a shorter version of this paper will be presented at this ICML workshop on beyond first order optimization methods or something like that. And there we actually also studied second order methods. Maybe if I kind of exit my screen, I can very, very briefly show you, not that a result. This is the result here. So I hope you can see it. Maybe you can't see it very well, actually. Can you see it, Case, or not?
It was better in the
okay.
Once what? Yeah, this is better. This is better. Yes.
Okay. So the reason second order methods are actually interesting is because under certain assumptions, what happens is that we are not actually able to make sure that the particles are converging and to optimality and to the same value. And so second order methods are interesting to make sure that this does happen. So this is relevant for the distributed setting. So in this plot, what you see is if we consider only the first order method, the orange line, we're at some point just stuck. We're no longer converging further to the optimum. But if we then look at this black line in which we are considering second order interacting mirror descent, we are converging way lower to our optimum. So second order is a good idea. We are trying to see if what exactly are going to be the benefits, in particular in distributed optimization. I think it will help to converge and to optimality and to consensus. Also details on that will come later, I guess.
All right. Thank you for your answers. I think you answered all the questions in the chat. So thanks again. Applause from my side.